Did everything home okay yesterday?
Mm-hmm.
From the 4-H part.
Yeah.
Okay. They tighten something up. Good.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good.
Great. I am glad it's not 1936. Those of you who follow the weather probably have noticed the highs, record highs, and I think most of them for the summer come from the year 1936. I shouldn't have said that, I suppose. If we'd been in 1936, we would have been fine, wouldn't we? We would have dealt with it. Took a step outside just before coming back in here and was absorbing the wonderful heat and humidity. And I was thinking, I remembered a wedding that Nancy and I participated in, one of the earlier churches we served back in the 1980s, and little congregation down in southern Champaign County that didn't have air conditioning. And, you know, the joys of 90-degree weather inside the building and grooves then passing out during the service. And yet they're all still doing okay. So I'm glad that you're here, that we can chuckle a little bit about the past. We can do that because we have hope before us. And so that's why we're here today. Not to hear me ramble, but to look to the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. We do hope that you'll take some time to fill out the registration pad. Even if you fill it out every week, that's actually one of the things that Charlotte likes for you to do, is to fill it out every week, because it makes her life a little bit easier. Because she knows she can't rely on me to tell her who's here on Sunday morning, because I generally don't remember that very well. We do also hope to make note of other announcements. Well, let's see. We do have some things to talk about real briefly. If that's possible for me, my wife says, don't pray very long because you don't read anything. That's why. Rummy sale week! Do I need to say any more? Well, I can't because I don't know anything about it. I'm excited. Daisy and I are excited about this. This is our first rummy sale. So, and we've got lots of stuff. From her mother, so anyway, yes, Shelley. Awakening will be here on Wednesday night because of Rummage Sale set up. So come and celebrate worship at 7 o'clock Wednesday night. Well, I guess if you need to know anything about the Rummage Sale, do you have anything to tell me? No?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
And I also am looking forward to our first time ever living in Fairbury during the Prairie Dirt Classic. That's on the schedule to happen this weekend. That didn't happen last year, after all. So if you ever grumble and say, you know, you're one of those folks, none of you here are, but I know some people who say, you know, I never have opportunities to witness. Well, if 10 or 15 or 20,000 people converge on Fairbury, you won't have to go too far to have opportunities. So, anyway, keep those things before you. Seriously, one thing, and I don't know why, I guess we do change. Sometimes we think we don't ever change, but I was thinking about change when I was looking at our living envelopes. If any of you have wondered about giving envelopes and would like to have giving envelopes, we still do have some. Right? Yeah.
Have you tried from Rachel that there's someone who gives you all the time if anyone wants an unbox?
Oh, see, but it shows how much I know what's going on. You got here all under why I'm talking about giving envelopes. Well, I thought it was really cool when we first came here to find one of these boxes. Took me back to my childhood. You know, we used to always get our own little box. We needed to do this kind of stuff. Any other special announcements? Well, two more that I want to share. In 2 weeks, some of you, not very many, but a few of you kind of been letting us know that you wanted to see some things change. So in 2 weeks, August the 8th, we're going to be having one worship service again at 10 o'clock, Sunday school at 9 o'clock, and we hope to have you all involved in as much as possible in both of those things. So spread the word in case there's still some folks out there that you maybe don't know. And then shortly thereafter, if that's not enough to get fired up, Kim Ernst and some of his compatriots in ministry are helping sponsor a revival over in Chatsworth, August the 15th to the 20th. So if you've been wondering why they haven't had a tent revival in the parking lot lately, well, this year it's going to be over in Chatsworth, downtown Chatsworth, right on the railroad, right next door. Keep that in mind. Anything else out there that maybe you have? Let's enjoy our prayer.
young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You see Jesus of Nazareth, who is crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, as he told you." If you'll please and join in hymn number 310, He Lives.
Nancy and I want to thank you all for your prayers for Benjamin and Jennifer, and Alan and Audrey and Evangeline and Isla. They made it to the Air Force Base yesterday and are in temporary housing outside of their base, actually close to the North Pole, Alaska. And are glad to be there. And thank you so much for your prayers for them. Also, thank you for your prayers for Nancy's mother. She's doing much better, and we've been amazed at her progress. Other updates that you want to lift up as far as any prayer concerns or additional prayer concerns that we're not aware of?
Yes. Our granddaughter Ellie left this morning for her visiting trip to Nashville.
All right, so
prayers for their safety and their safety.
So let's pray for the Nashville attendants. That the inner high group, as they go down for Ellie and others as they go to share their faith.
Where the people are continuing to get over the hurt of someone who is in the last couple of days here in our community, and then they're in the role of our
community. Yes, please do continue to pray for those who are struggling with COVID. For wisdom for all of us. Faithfulness as we live and move forward. Well, let's pray together. Glorious God, our Heavenly Father, you inspired the psalmist to declare, praise ye the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit, stirring our hearts and our minds, strengthening us, lifting up, even making strong as your word, in your word, your servants would often declare, making strong our feeble knees, that we would be able to rise up in body and in spirit and praise you. And we are so grateful, O God, for giving us your word to guide us, to teach us, to lead us, inspire us, for giving us the body of Christ, the church, that on a time such as this we can gather together and worship, as we each come seeking to glorify you, to receive from you the empowerment we need, but also knowing that by being together, your Spirit stirs us up and works through us in the individual gifting of your Spirit in our lives. That we might be an encouragement to one another and go forth once again reminded that we are not alone, that we are part of the body. We do pray for the body of Christ and its upbuilding and strengthening. In this time, we are so grateful that we continue to see your church in mission and ministry. We pray for Ellie and for those other youth and adults who are traveling to Tennessee, that they would be inspired and encouraged to share and serve, and that other lives would be touched because of this. We thank you for the many ministries we share in our local community and throughout the world, and the opportunities we have to hear of what you are doing in the lives of your people. We praise you for those who we've heard that have experienced healing, who have been sick, and who have faced difficulty, illness, and injury. We praise you for allowing us to be able to celebrate and to intercede on behalf of others who are in that dark time right now, and illness and difficulty. May it always be true that the light of your love in Jesus Christ would be present among us, so that there might be that stirring of your hope and encouragement that we need to be able to press forward, the confidence and assurance of that perfect and holy day that is yet to dawn for us. Lord, we are so grateful that we can minister to one another in the authority and power of Jesus Christ, in the love and compassion that you stir in our hearts and minds. We come and ask you to do in us today what we need so that we might be able to continue faithfully. These things and all the others that we have each lifted upon our own hearts to you this day, we remember that you tell us our prayers are sent to you as a fragrant offering, and so we pray that they will be pleasing in your sight. We ask all of this in the precious name of Jesus, we ask as your church to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Around us in the world never seems to cease. We live in a broken world, but yet
We are reminding folks every day in the good news of Jesus that it's not always going to be that way. So thank you for the way that you help support those things. Would you pray with me? Gracious Father, once again we are reminded that every one of us are here today because we have had faithful witnesses in our lives. Certainly the authority of your word and scripture, the stirring of your Holy Spirit, but also the saints who have gone before us who have shown us and witnessed and taught us. Lord God, we are grateful. Even though at times it's challenging, we're grateful that you remind us that now is our time to be living that bold and humble life of service, lifting up the gospel, calling folks to Jesus. So we pray that as we give to you today, our lives, our service, our witness would be pleasing and honoring you. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him an oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and has poured out what we now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Thank you for your word, Lord.
Thank you, Dan. To join together in confessing our faith using our creed beneath the last 2 weeks, join with me.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He is spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Pray with me. Lord God, we thank you for your witness to us, that you made yourself known to us, and that we have the Scriptures. We have statements of faith and the testimony and the witness of the saints who've gone before us. And we have, through the gift of faith in Jesus Christ, your Holy Spirit stirring us. We pray that you would stir up in us today, O God, faith and confidence in you, so that we might continue to live in the joy that Jesus Christ gives to us and share the light of
his love in this world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So Ivan, what do I, can you tell from way up there what I have here?
Some sort of a thing that isn't
high enough. Yes, you could. This is actually part of the flashlight.
Oh.
It's the bottom part that you fasten on that holds the batteries in place and helps.
Why does that have a
loop
at the back?
The loop?
Why does it have a loop at the back?
I suppose so you could carry it like this. You know, if you wanted to carry it. If you were working or something, you didn't want to lose it while you were outside. I don't know, you probably never did this, but sometimes I fall down or stumble and drop things. This way, you know, if that happens.
Can you just put it off this way? You can have it take it in the ear.
The other thing that I wanted to share with you, though, is, and you can't tell from up here, up there, is that this flashlight doesn't work. Obviously, it would help if I had batteries, right? But even, I discovered this has been a while, it's been laying on my dresser. I put some new batteries in it and it still didn't work. So then, I started trying to clean up this electrical contacts, and as you might have, some of you can see, noticed some of it's falling apart. Which is not a good sign. And then the other thing I thought about doing, I haven't gotten around to yet, is changing the light bulb. That might help too, right? Well, there's a reason why I brought this with me, because believe it or not, I probably, more than likely, if I was willing to spend the time and energy and a little bit of money, it wouldn't cost a lot. To work on this, I probably more likely to get it to work again. Because the basic structure of the flashlight is all still good. Yes?
If you really did want a thing that you can have around you that projects light and reflects when you want to, could you just get a headband?
You could get a headband.
You probably projects light in the way that you're looking.
Some people like wearing headband lights. I don't like them myself. I don't like that. For some reason, I just don't like the way that feels around my head.
Or a hat.
Or a hat, yeah. That kind of deal. But the reason I brought this morning and wanted to talk to you a little bit about this non-functioning flashlight is because, believe it or not, in a way, it kind of reminds me a little bit about the promise of resurrection that we have through faith in Jesus Christ. Even better than fixing a flashlight, however, because sooner or later, with time, the structure of this flashlight would begin to fail. That little spring part at the bottom that fell off is already an indication of that. Because that's supposed to be crimped in there so it won't come out. But because of corrosion around the edge that you can't see, but that's on here, it's starting to fail. But Jesus promises us, as incredible as it might seem, that He is going to raise us. Raise us for judgment. For life, for those who have faith in Him, and the Scripture says wrath and condemnation for those of us who refuse to have faith. And the interesting thing about it is that sometimes we get hung up on thinking that God is kind of an angry God, but the fact of the matter is it's just like with this flashlight. It's up to me. If I really want this flashlight to work, then I'll decide to do what it takes to fix it. And if I want to have the promise of resurrection assured, then it's up to me to decide to believe. But lots of other folks tell me what the Word of God tells me and what God's Spirit is actually stirring every day to remind me.
especially our youth and children, to be soundly taught, to hear the good news of your love for them, and to know that you make available to all of us the opportunity to choose life and life eternal in Jesus Christ. We pray this in his name. Amen. Well, I suspect none of you here this morning, or those of you that may be watching online, probably none of you would have been thinking this, but in 1982, August the 1st, that was the first Sunday that Nancy and I began this journey with Jesus of serving as a pastoral family and a church. And one of the things that emerged fairly quickly in that little country church where we were loved and taught, and I think we learned a whole lot more than we did for the folks in the church, but one of the things that we experienced is that sometimes folks feel like we get a little bit confused or are distracted or spend too much time on certain things. Nancy used to sit with our oldest daughter, Ellen, when she was the baby when we moved there. And then when Mary was born, which happened while we were at that little church as well, she used to sit. A lot of folks were gracious and would sit around her so that they could be distracted and not have to listen to the preacher. Oh, I'm sorry. That's probably not true. But maybe it was. But anyway, they would sit around her and help her, which she greatly appreciated. There were a number of folks who were being willing to hold the kids, especially once Mary was born. One of them was having some difficulty and help out. It was just a great benefit to her. But one of the saints in that church was not afraid to say what she thought. And Nancy would often tell me an earful of things that she had heard during worship. Things like, that should have been the sermon after the prayer time. But I told you all that simply to say, I do remember what today is. It is July 25th. I don't think it's Easter. Dorothy would have probably been second to Ray. Is he confused? Does he think it's Easter? Because we sang these wonderful hymns this morning. There's a couple things that you've probably begun to learn about me. I don't necessarily feel we ought to pigeonhole things necessarily. There's a lot of wonderful hymns that we can say anytime. And I would certainly hope that any time we gather and worship, I sure hope that when you're driving down the road or you're sitting having coffee, occasionally the message of the words of hymns of resurrection will pop into your mind. The Spirit of God will remind you of those things. Because I know I need that reminder. And, we have this occasional custom around the Midwest of celebrating Christmas in July. So why not Easter? Well, seriously, I wanted to ask you to think. We've been talking a little bit about the things that are actually foundational statements of our faith. You know, the creed that we used for the last couple of weeks. The messages that I've been trying to share with you, and that I've been thinking a lot about are based upon what we call in the church our articles of religion, which sometimes folks say Methodist, United Methodists can believe whatever they want. Well, yeah, that's not really true. We do have statements of faith. We do have articles of religion that we've inherited from the Catholic Church, and I don't mean capital C, but the Church Universal. And one of the things that's at the heart of who we are is our belief in the resurrection. And it begs just a gentle reminder that you and I wouldn't be here right now if it wasn't for the resurrection of Jesus. I know that's a simple statement to make, If you haven't thought about that, let me think about that. You wouldn't be here this morning if Jesus hadn't risen from the dead. And that's not a new insight. In Acts chapter 5, a few weeks ago we read this, but in Acts chapter 5, as the people of the Jewish community are wrestling with what to do with these first Christians and are perplexed and troubled by it because they're just stirring everything up and messing up their ordered lives as they see it. And they've arrested them and are trying to figure out what to do with them. Some of them want to kill them. Others want to just beat them. And you might recall that Gamaliel, one of the rabbis, stands up and bears witness to the Jewish council that they need to be careful. And he shares with them this insight. Now, remember, of course, this has been 2,000 years, roughly ago. He said to them, "Men of Israel, take care of what you do with these men. For before these days," this is in Acts 5, starting verse 35, "before these days, Theudas arose." Have you ever heard of Theudas? Well, maybe if you've read Acts 5. Theudas arose, giving himself out to be somebody. And a number of men, about 400, joined him. Hey, that's a pretty big group, right? That's more than we've got here this morning. So Theudas must have had something going. "But he was slain, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing." That has happened again and again and again and again and again. Even prior to this time, it had happened. People who were charismatic, people who thought they had a message from God, people who thought they were important political leaders, religious or not, had risen and had drawn groups of people and had done something that appeared to be amazing and powerful and mighty, and then they're dead. And nothing comes of it. Jesus, even though you know as well as I do, there are folks that don't believe in the resurrection. But we have this evidence, brothers and sisters, and you are part of that. Jesus was crucified, dead, laid in the tomb, and rose. And you are part of the testimony simply by being in faith in Jesus Christ. This is true. Because if it wasn't true, it would have come to nothing. I mean, it doesn't take a great deal of insight to figure that out. Most of you know that I was reared on a farm and still have connection with family farm back home, and I love it, and I love being in the community like Fairbury that's surrounded by farms, and a lot of you are connected to the farm as well. We can swap stories and share wonderful encouragement and things that we enjoy about life. Kind of like John Denver and that song, "Life on the Farm," is kind of like that. Nothing an old country boy like me can't have. Early to rise and early to sack. Thank God I'm a country boy. Remember that? Well, I do. But not just because of all that romance. Because part of what we share together is steeped every single day, kind of like if you're making coffee or making tea or brewing sun tea or some of you that maybe used to make sassafras tea like my mom would do occasionally. We've been steeped in the faith and the witness to the resurrection. And all around us, we have those encouraging tidbits. I was thinking about that a bit recently, as I've been seeing occasional reminders, I get an email every other day or so from an auction service that specializes in vintage farm equipment. And, you know, it's kind of like looking at the Sears Roebuck catalog all over again. You know, I look at all these old tractors. Boy, that would be great. Wouldn't that be wonderful? But, you know, here's the thing. And you guys know this already. You know, these tractors that cost $2,800 or $6,000 or $11,000 when they were new, what do they cost now? And there's a part of me that wrestles with that and says, this just isn't right. You know, another thing that you maybe haven't quite figured out yet, but I'm pretty scotch. It's hard for me to justify. That's why I've got a broken flashlight. And maybe it'll make it to the rubbish sale. Shelly has always reminded everybody that I'm not allowed into the rubbish sale because I may be looking for my stuff. That Nancy sneaks over here. You know, how do you justify spending $40,000 on a $5,000 tractor? You know, there's that tension in my brain that I wrestle with. But what helps me to get over that hurdle when it does happen, doesn't always happen, unfortunately, but what helps me to get over that hurdle every now and then is, what is that valued at today? What would it take for that to be produced today on the line of farm equipment? And you know better than I do, because I don't keep track of it. And those same old tractors that I love, you know, even though, of course, we know that they've changed a lot, to accomplish, though, the same literal physical work, which is why we have them, after all. You're talking $150,000. You go out to buy one now. Well, I told you all of that simply to just say, one of the things that we are called to remember about the value of life is that our Lord knows the cost. Jesus understands better than any of us, and he understands us perfectly well what it costs for our lives to be lifted up and redeemed and transformed and made whole. Because after all, as we profess, we believe that he understands the cost in the first place in God choosing to create, and certainly understands better than anyone the cost of salvation. And he declares that we're worth that cost. And invites us to believe against belief sometimes in the hope of resurrection. Reminded and reminding each other, allowing God's Word and God's Spirit to remind us again and again that it's not an empty hope. As the Apostle Paul would write to the church of Thessalonica, we are not as those who have no hope in 1 Thessalonians 4. Because our hope is hung, we've chosen to hang our hope, everything about it, on the person of Jesus, who despite the world's view, we know has risen from the dead because of the enduring, life-changing witness that's happening all around us. And just in case, occasionally, we get a little discouraged because the overflow section's not filled, let's remind one another that's not our hope. Our hope is in the one who can save all of those folks and has already chosen to do it and is asking us, like Peter and John and like Paul and like those saints in your life to allow God to stir us up enough today to share the love of Jesus Christ. That this Jesus that God has raised up, we will be witnesses to. Because we know what God has done in Jesus is true. Especially in those moments when we feel like an old, rusty, burnout tractor lying in a ditch somewhere. Because we know that there's one who is willing to pay the price, not just to restore us, but to rebirth us, and to give us the assurance of life abundant and eternal. I mentioned earlier the Articles of our Religion. This was part of the 1784 discipline of the Methodist Church back then. Article 3 is in that of the resurrection of Christ. Christ did truly rise again from the dead. He took again his body, all things appertaining to the perfection of man's nature. That means you. Wherewith he ascended into heaven, and there he sits until he returns to judge all men at the last day. We believe this, even if it's not fashionable, because we know that Jesus is trustworthy and faithful. He doesn't change like the fashions do in our world. As Paul reminded us, continues to remind us, if this isn't true, if Christ hasn't been raised, then all of this is in vain. Your faith is in vain. Jumping a few verses, he goes on to say, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. First fruits of those who have fallen asleep. You know, if you have a friend who doesn't believe in the resurrection, who's struggling, who wants to have something to hang their life on, who's looking for hope and purpose in life, just tell them that you believe because Jesus has been raised from the dead. After all, folks have been trying to say that if it wasn't true, you wouldn't be believing it anymore. And you know that's true. If it wasn't, let's invite our friends. Let's invite our family members. Let's invite anyone and everyone who is either opposed or lukewarm or who could care less to know that Jesus has given his life for them. And we know he has risen from the dead because there's far too much fruit and far too much evidence for us not to believe. Even if we're going through a rough patch, even if we're wrestling with some difficulties, because we know our hope is not in ourselves or in our health or in our wealth. Our hope is in resurrected Jesus. Pray with me. God, we thank you for doing that which no one would have ever expected. And they didn't. We read that in the Gospels. They didn't expect it. Yet Jesus rose from the dead and he lives. And he invites us to fall before him and say, here I am, Lord, I give my life to you. Please work in me the power of your Spirit, give me life. Stir up in me the hope and the confidence to live today and to look forward to life, resurrected life, with you forever. Lord, help us share that truth with everyone we have the opportunity to touch, especially one or two aside. As we ask in Jesus' wonderful name, amen. Please stand as we sing together.
John Wesley said on his deathbed, the best of all is, God is with us. As we were singing that hymn, I was thinking about Kirby Todd, a family friend who used to teach square dancing. I've never been a dancer, but Kirby could lead just about anybody. You know, you and I don't have to take the lead. We have a leader who will guide us and lead us in this dance of life. So let's go forward in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.